শোনো, এটা না হোয়াটসঅ্যাপটা আসছে তো,
সুমিত সাইড অন লাইভ অন
দাদা
গুড ইভিনিং এন্ড আ ভেরি ওয়ার্ম ওয়েলকাম
বন্ধ
টু অল আওয়ার ভিউয়ার্স টুডে হু হ্যাভ জয়েন্ড আস টু অ্যাটেন্ড দ্য নেক্সট এপিসোড অফ দিস ওয়ান্ডারফুল সিরিজ অফ ওয়েবিনারস অন বিহাফ অফ IAP Bangalore and IAP Karnataka. I welcome all our viewers as well as our esteemed faculty for this evening. It's a great honor for us and it's a great honor for me to introduce our esteemed speaker for this evening, Dr. Apurva Ghosh, who is a professor and director of the Institute of Child Health, Kolkata. I'd like to reiterate our gratitude to Central IAP President Dr. Bakul Parekh and HSG Dr. Basuraj for their continued support in all our webinar activities, as well as the support extended by Dr. Shantraj, who is the President of IAP Karnataka, and Dr. Natesh, who is the Secretary of IAP Karnataka, for their support. Dr. Apurva is known for a lot of his work, which is done in the field of infectious diseases, and we are indeed fortunate to have him today with us to share his experience. I'd like to place on record our gratitude to all the team of GSK Pharma who have facilitated this webinar today and for having supported us in this activity today. So I'd like to thank Mr. Rishabh, Mr. Anil, Mr. Mainak, and Ms. Vidya. Of course, she is not, I think she has not joined us as yet, but thank you so much for all your efforts in bringing Dr. Apurva to our platform this evening. And without much ado, I would like to now hand over to Dr. Apurva Ghosh to take us through his experience on pneumonia and pneumonia mimics. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm really honored and grateful to the Karnataka Academy of Pediatrics for inviting me and allowing me to deliver this lecture, which is nothing a lecture but my experience over the last 30, 40 years. So my topic is pneumonia and pneumonia mimics. Let me be honest that I'm not a pulmonologist, because when I started my career, there was no pediatric pulmonologist. So though I wanted to be, there was no scope for that. And so I will wear a pediatrician's hat. Now, before I start, I want to remember my boss, my teacher, Dr. Shishir Kumar Bose, who was the first editor of the Academy of Pediatrics and also the convener of the Constitution Committee of Indian Academy of Pediatrics. But the reason I also adore, he's the first pediatric radiologist of India who was trained in Boston Children's Hospital. But more than that, he is the one who drove Netaji from his house, from the eyes of the British at the age of 21 years, drove him from his house in the night, went to Bihar near Gomo and came back dropping Netaji. Netaji from there went to Kabul and the rest is a history. But Dr. Bose was arrested and was taken to Lahore jail. So I really admire him because of his contribution to the national history of independence. I'm also grateful to my teacher, Dr. S.P. Ghoshal, was the president of Indian Academy of Pediatrics, under whom I did my MD. Both of them were born in 1920, and so this is their centenary year. Usual fate of my audience is like this. I will try not to, but still, usually that's the fate. The problem with chest X-ray, because one looks at so many chest X-rays, familiarity may create a false sense of security and confidence rather than an expertise. When I look at a chest X-ray, I usually have a formula for the students and for myself also, that it is DT scar. Now, D for diaphragm, T for trachea, S for scapula, spine, subcutaneous tissue, C for clavicle, and A for abdomen, and R for ribs. The reason I have omitted the lungs and the heart is because we always try to look at the heart and the lungs, ignoring the other parts of the X-ray. Now, this child came to me for 14 years back with this chest X-ray for a cough and cold. But what was missed in this chest X-ray is, I will show you in the subsequent one, is that I did the skull X-ray immediately and found a lot of Wormian bones in the skull. And as you can see, these are the Wormian bones. So when you look at the chest X-ray, you see that there is no clavicle. With the loss of no clavicle, lot of Wormian bones, it becomes a cleidocranial dysostosis, which should have been diagnosed from the chest X-ray itself, but was missed. And then this is the X-ray at 14 years of age, and you can see the clavicle is not there. And this is the maneuver this child can do, which is an autosomal dominant condition in the chromosome 6. Now you can have a genetic diagnosis for this. Now, this is another condition where the clavicle are very hypoplastic, very, very thin in an adult, almost 16, 17 year old child. The clavicles are very thin. And if you look at the child, this is the one. So that's what happens in progeria. The clavicle becomes almost either non-visible or becomes fibrotic. You may feel the clavicle, but it may not come in the X-ray. So we did this is the largest family of progeria so far in the world, and we did a gene study, and it was a laminacy homozygous gene. Now this is what our residents and the consultants missed. This child came with fever, cough, cold, and anemia, but this was missed, that in the clavicle there is something in osteolytic. This turned out to be a leukemia patient afterwards. So you must look at the clavicle also. The next comes the ribs. The ribs, you can see, if you don't look at this properly, there is an osteomyelitis of the ribs, which will be missed if you don't look. And as I said, that you need to look at the abdomen also. This child had a pneumonia, but if you look at the abdominal X-ray properly, there are a lot of gas shadows. So this is a necrotizing enterocolitis with a pneumonia. So don't look at the X-ray only. There is something very characteristic in the abdomen X-ray also. So gash in the portal vein. This is another where the X-ray is showing pneumonia, but there are few signs, very classic signs, which are signs of meconium peritonitis. So with this meconium peritonitis, with this X-ray in a newborn neonate, it is very, very likely that this is going to be a cystic fibrosis case in future. Now, this is an X-ray where it was said with a fever, very high fever. But the interesting part is that this child was having a high platelet count. And it was said that there is a pleural reaction because of this. But this is not pleural reaction. With a high count, high fever, everyone thinks of Kawasaki disease nowadays. But the people forget that this might be a Caffey's disease. And I still remember the Caffey's disease because my boss, Dr. Shishir Bose, reported a lot of Caffey's disease cases, and his name was in the Caffey's books in the previous editions. And it also has changes in the mandible. It can be changes in the scapula. Now, this is a child came with the respiratory distress. Now, the X-ray is very, very characteristic. But if you don't think of it, and if you don't look at the chest properly, you will not be able to diagnose this case. Now, what my boss told me, that when you see an X-ray, and if you think something is wrong in the X-ray, especially in the ribs, turn it upside down. When you see an X-ray without turning upside down, the heart and lungs catches your eyes. But if you turn it upside down, you see the ribs catches our eyes first, and you can see that the ribs are better, and the lateral X-ray showed that this is a thoracic dystrophy, and there are changes in this pelvis also. So seeing a chest X-ray will not give you the diagnosis all the time. Now this girl, 8-year-old girl, came to us with the history that cough. Initially, it was told, because there was not much of fever, it was told that it is a viral cough. Then after a few days, it was azithromycin was started. Then it said that it's a bacterial cough. And then when it didn't subside, then it was said that it is a whooping cough. Then the psychogenic cough, because the child was otherwise well. And then lastly, when did the chest x-ray, they said that it is a tuberculosis. There is a calcified lymph node and there is a pulmonary lesion. Now, it is very difficult for the parents to digest this so many diagnoses in so many 15 days. So they came to us, and on examination, I found that one of the tooth is missing. Now, we, the Bengalis, have the habit of keeping this tooth either under the soil or in a box. We don't throw it off. I say that this is the tooth which your child has aspirated, and we have taken it out by bronchoscopy, and you see that the x-ray is clear. So the clinical examination clue here that one of the tooth is missing. When I said that when did it fall, they said, we don't know. It has been aspirated most probably at night. So when do you need an expiratory film rather than an inspiratory film that we usually is the pneumothorax, the foreign body, and the thymus. Now, thymus is a trick. If you have learned to examine the thymus, you have learned almost 90% of the chest x-rays. This is a 6-month with prominent thymus, very characteristic sale sign. But this is another child who is having a sale sign, but this is called Spinnaker sale sign in pneumomediastinum. So almost similar, one needs to be very careful here that whether it's a pneumomediastinum or not. The next question is that, is chest x-ray good enough for the diagnosis of pneumonia? Using a CT as the gold standard that you see nowadays, many hospitals are admitting the patients after doing a CT to exclude COVID infection. Now, the sensitivity of the chest x-ray is 43% and specificity is 93%. But clinically, you diagnose pneumonia, but nothing in the CT in 33% cases. So, clinical diagnosis of pneumonia is wrong in 33% of the cases. Now, this is a very characteristic chest x-ray, solid lower consolidation. There is nothing new in it. But what I mean to say that if the fever is for the less than 3 days, the tachypnea will not be there. We always say three criteria, that tachycardia, tachypnea, and feeding problems. Fever, feeding, and fast breathing, I call it 3F. First 3 days, you will not get the tachypnea. And in these cases, are treated like pneumococcal pneumonia. It's one of the most common cause, which is seen after 6 months, 3 to 6 months, and all throughout you can see the pneumococcus tops the list. And the staphylococcus, which is much more serious to me, has two peaks. One, it around 6 months, and the other one is around 6 years of age. The rest of the causes, I'm not going into detail. The distinguishing between viral and bacterial pneumonia radiologically, though we say, but it is not that easy. In one of the studies by Birki, it has been shown that 72% of those with bacterial etiology had an alveolar infect. This is an alveolar infect in 72%. But you might get the same 49% with solely viral pneumonia had an alveolar infect rate. And about this interstitial changes that you see here, in 50% of viral and 50% of bacterial. So it's difficult from a chest x-ray to say that whether it is viral or bacterial. And that is the reason in USA, 11 million doses of antibiotics are given every year, overdose, giving antibiotics in viral infections. Some clue is that if you have got a single chill, it is Streptococcus pneumoniae. But if you have got multiple chills, very likely that in older child it is staphylococcus, in younger babies it is Klebsiella pneumonia. This is the PARCH study funded by Bill and Melinda Gates in 7 countries. Now, what was the result of this PARCH study? That only 9% is bacteria, and most common is Streptococcus pneumoniae. The rest is virus or mixed. I'm not going into the detail. This shadow is like a round shadow. Now, if you have a round shadow, most common cause for that is the pneumococcal pneumonia. Because of the underdevelopment of the pores of Corn and pores of Lambert, round shadows are common in children, but you don't get these shadows in adults, in pneumonia. If you get such a shadow in an adult, think of a tumor rather than a pneumonia. And this is one condition. Our IIP guideline says that you don't need to repeat the X-ray. And this guideline is imported from mainly from the British guidelines. But I say that if you have a round pneumonia, you should repeat an X-ray after 6 weeks. More so in our country, because of the tuberculosis, I prefer to show the parents that yes, we have cleared it. And the other reason is that sometimes the parents demand that see a check that whether it has been cleared or not. Tuberculosis, Klebsiella can be a cause. So that's what I said, that the follow-up X-ray may be necessary when it is a round pneumonia, collapse, or persisting of symptoms. This child came with a fever. It's almost homogeneous of pacification of whole of the right lobe. So initially, I thought it must be an empyema. So I was about to put a needle into this. This is long back, about 13 years back. I was about to put a needle. But then in a second thought, I thought that let me do an ultrasound of the chest. And what I found is that there is only a chink of fluid and the whole lung is consolidated. So I didn't put the needle, just carried on with the antibiotics and it got cleared off. So here comes the role of ultrasound in chest X-ray. And it has been nicely depicted in this article by Annie Sofian et al. What they say that the ultrasound has got a very high negative predictive value of 99% cases. And it is usually 98% sensitive and 92% specific. So try to do and try to teach your residents and registrars the ultrasound of the chest. In my hospital, I have kept two ultrasound machine in the indoor, one in the PICU and one in the general ward, so that at any point of time the residents can do and the ultrasound of the chest. So this X-ray didn't show pneumonia, but when you do the ultrasound, you see hyperintense lesions, and these are actually the pneumonia. And now we are conducting a study that role of ultrasound of the chest in the PEO of the patient. This is a 2-month-old. What is characteristic in this chest X-ray is that there is a bulging of the fissure and little bit of cavitation. That's very characteristic at 2 months of age of Klebsiella pneumoniae. So choose your antibiotic, choose an aminoglycoside in these cases, because it's a theoretically and correct X-ray-wise, it's a Klebsiella. The similar X-ray is the bulging fissure sign. And this is what the bulging fissure is, because of the intralobar tension, because this tension cannot be relieved. As I said in the beginning, that the pores of Corn and pores of Lambert are not developed. So there is accumulation of pressure within. And other than Klebsiella, Streptococcus pneumoniae also can. This is a very characteristic X-ray where you see that the heart is covered by some shadows. This is called shaggy heart, and this is very characteristic of whooping cough or Chlamydia or trachomatis infection. In 1980s, when I was doing my post-graduation, there was a line in Nelson's textbook of pediatrics that if you suspect staphylococcus, do X-ray almost every day. Unfortunately, that has been taken off. There must be some reason, but I still follow that if I suspect the staphylococcus, I do the X-ray, and that is what you see, that within 48 hours, there is development of the empyema. The next common problem that we are now seeing is the necrotizing pneumonia, which is on the rise. And the two important causes for necrotizing pneumonia is pneumococci and staphylococcus. There is reason for staphylococcus because it produces PVL, which causes the necrotizing pneumonia. But what is important that if you are vaccinating a child with without strain 3 and strain 19, both of them are very invasive, and especially the strain 3, because of this thick capsule, it avoids opsonophagocytosis. So pneumococcus and staphylococcus can necrotizing pneumonia, and this is a necrotizing pneumonia. Now, when do you have the necrotizing pneumonia? Here comes the problem of MRSA, which is now on the rise like anything. There are a lot of causes where you can cavitary necrosis. If you have got concurrent influenza, if you have got hemoptysis, if you have got rapidly increasing pleural effusion, neutropenia, most probably due to PVL, pentavalentine, leukocytine production, erythematous rash, if you see, always think of that it might be a staphylococcus and especially MRSA, skin pustule, young previously healthy patient, and severe pneumonia during summer months. And this is what this child is photographed after the child recovered during that acute stage. We couldn't take the photograph, but you see this erythematous rash and there was pain. So what we did an MRI, and MRI showed that he had an osteomyelitis. We follow the ALARA principles, means as low as radiation as achievable. So instead of doing the CT scan, we do the MRI, because MRI gives an idea about the soft tissue. It gives you an idea about the bone marrow edema, which may not be very good, seen in properly in CT scan. And what we see in the chest X-ray, there are a lot of necrotic areas. The CT scan also showed that there are a lot of necrosis. So this child was a MRSA. And the reason the MRSA, you see, we are not been able to do the staphylococcal chromosomal cassette 4 and 5. And if you carry that, that is an MRSA, which is community acquired MRSA. And as I say, that the magnetic resonance can detect osteomyelitis in 78% to 90%, whereas CT scan will detect in 67%. PET scan, of course, will give you a much better chance, but it's quite costly. So the difference between community acquired and hospital acquired is that the antibiotic resistance, staphylococcal chromosomal cassette 4 and 5 make elements. These are actually lighter element, and this lighter element can be transmitted. And as you know, that the community acquired MRSA started from the MSSA, and especially the gram-negative one. And with that, that the phage typing, the resistance, and the PVL gene has been introduced. And as I said, that acute osteomyelitis, if you find nowadays, it's more of community acquired MRSA. And if you see the venous thrombosis and skin lesions, it is more likely. Now, remember one thing, that we give a vancomycin for lung infection, but the concentration of the vancomycin in adults in alveoli is only 18%. That's one factor that we should think of, though whether you will translate it into practice or not, that's up to you. But remember that if it doesn't improve, then think of linezolid, which has got a very good penetration to the lungs. I will also want to highlight two things. One, that we still use vancomycin rather than teicoplanin. Remember that the teicoplanin cost has come down, and to the extent that teicoplanin is now below the price of vancomycin. Whereas vancomycin has to be given 3 to 4 times a day, your teicoplanin can be given once daily. So you save the children's pain. Vancomycin destroys the vein more than the teicoplanin. And in this COVID situation, and as you know, in many places, the nursing shortage is there. So we have shifted, excepting if it is the CNS infection, where probably vancomycin has a better penetration than teicoplanin. And necrotizing pneumonia, of course, can be due to anything, bacteria, virus, and fungus. Out of that, adenovirus infection causes more of necrotizing pneumonia that we should remember. Coming to this X-ray, Shishir Bose used to say, like the lower consolidation that I showed you looks very nice, but this is an ugly pneumonia, he used to say. If you say, see an ugly pneumonia, think of mycoplasma. Now we can check the PCR, and we checked in this 14-year-old child, it turned out to be a mycoplasma. Now, what's the drug that you should use in this case? As you know, as I said, that mycoplasma can involve alveolus or the interstitial part. The other causes of atypical pneumonia are all these. I'm not going into the details because less common in our country. But mycoplasma initially was called atypical pneumonia for quite some time. But recently, people are not in favor of using the term because the consolidation is found in 59%, single lobar in 32%. Even pleural effusion and hilar lymphadenopathy. So people are not using mycoplasma as nowadays as atypical pneumonia. In the EPIC study, the mycoplasma is more common than the streptococcus pneumoniae. So always think of mycoplasma. And this is a personal communication with Dr. Bala from Chennai. He also said that the prevalence in 30% of the cases. Feature that mycoplasma sometimes can present is that you can have a mucosal lesions, you can have conjunctivitis, and you can have target lesions in the hand. And this disease has been described in different literatures by different names. They say MPM, that is mycoplasma associated mucositis. They say mycoplasma induced rash and mucositis, MIRM. And some people in Germany call it Fuchs syndrome. Now, in pediatrics, 2014 came out a systemic review, but the conclusion is that insufficient evidence to support or refute the treatment of mycoplasma. Many people think that it is a self-limiting disease. Now, what are the drugs you use? Is the macrolide, doxycycline, and fluoroquinolones. Here comes the problem. See the problem. See, in all these parts, including the India in the middle, the mycoplasma resistance in Japan, China has gone up to 97%, 87%. We do not have any Indian data, Indian study. And only that I could search, and after talking to my one of my junior, who is an MD in pharmacology, DM in pharmacology, they said, sir, this is only I could find out for you a scientific letter in Indian Journal of Pediatrics that it can be registered. So I prefer doxycycline nowadays if I'm thinking of mycoplasma, either azithromycin or doxycycline, whether it's a scrub or mycoplasma, especially in slightly older children. But remember in 2018, June, the American Academy of Pediatrics has taken up the ceiling that it cannot be used below 8 years. The reason for that is that doxycycline binds with the calcium much less than the tetracycline. So it does not stain the tooth, and you can use and it at all ages and avoid sun exposure while you are giving doxycycline because it is photosensitive. This is a child where you see there's a very bad X-ray. But the clinical clue was that the X-ray was bad, but the patient was not that distressed. It's only at 1 month, 6 days old. So immediately, considering that in tuberculosis, you have this type of features. X-ray looks bad. Patient may not be that bad. So we did a alveolar lavage, gastric aspirate, and it is 3 plus AB. Mother initial x-ray was negative, but after 3 months, it is positive. So it was from the mother, maybe in utero, and the mode of infection in newborn babies are three. One is hematologic, where your liver and spleen may be enlarged, both the lungs are equally involved. In utero aspiration, where the right lung is more involved than the left, or postpartum inhalation or ingestion. In this case, most probably because of the right lung is more involved, it is most probably a in utero aspiration. Now, this is a 10-year-old child. Came with this picture, but we did the bronchoalveolar lavage. We got the acid first bacilli. And that was positive for DNA TBPCR. But the fever was not subsiding. On the other hand, after antitubercular drugs, it was rising. So we did a bone marrow, and bone marrow revealed plenty of hemophagocytics. So the pulmonary tuberculosis with ARDS, with hemophagocytic syndrome, so we published. Now, what is from Japan, you see, the tuberculosis-associated hemophagocytosis. When we think of, when we see a case of hemophagocytic syndrome or HLH, we think of Epstein-Barr virus, we think of cytomegalovirus, but think of tuberculosis also. You see, here if it is 35, 15, and the third most common cause is tuberculosis. So don't forget that the tuberculosis can be a cause of HLH. When I was a student, this is a diagnosis. I found a little bit of difficulty in pronouncing this disease, and this is the swelling, but in a very happy child. And if you do the x-ray, you see this, and the MUN2 was strongly positive. So this is empyema necessitatis due to tuberculosis. Very characteristic picture. Now, this is again a similar picture. It was swollen, but the picture was taken when the patient was slightly better, because when the patient is very serious, it's difficult to take a photograph. And if you see the x-ray, there is a necrosis here. See the CT scan, it has tracked down to the subcutaneous tissue, and this is empyema necessitatis due to an MRSA. MRSA is necrotizing, and it can cause your empyema necessitatis due to MRSA infection. The picture on the left is one of my patients when I was working abroad. Is an ABPA patient in cystic fibrosis. Very characteristic pictures you get in ABPA, and they are called wandering shadows. The shadow may be here, shadow may be sometimes there, wandering shadows. There may be central bronchiectasis and others like this if you don't treat them properly right in the beginning and think of it. And this is one where there is bronchiectasis, fibrosis, central bronchiectasis, mainly the central part. But you see, the ABPA is somehow or other in pediatrics is not that much discussed. Though India contributes to almost 1/3 of the total cases in the world. About 5 million cases in the world, 1.4 million cases are India alone. There is other disease which is called ABPM, which is not ABPA, the aspergillosis, but other mycosis. So that's a new term which is called ABPM, not ambulatory blood pressure monitoring. And the other interesting part, and I'm proud that the guideline that has been formulated for the diagnosis of ABPA is mainly these two persons from Dr. Agarwal and Dr. Chakravarti Shah. And that's the international guideline. Their contribution is the maximum. Now, how do you manage that? You manage with steroid, but you need a low dose of steroid of 0.5 milligram per kg for 2 to 4 weeks, and then tail it off in 3 months. Itraconazole, 10 milligram, some says 5 milligram. Voriconazole and posaconazole can also be used, because itraconazole causes gastric irritation, which is not done by voriconazole, and you need to continue it for 2 to 3 months. Omalizumab and inhaled amphotericin B are other theoretical options that you can have. Long back, this child came in 2004 from Bangladesh with a diagnosis of asthma. And amongst the chest diseases, I think the asthma misdiagnosis is one of the highest one. And this child was not thought of asthma in spite of his malnutrition and in spite of clubbing. Remember that two conditions, clubbing is less. One is your asthma. In tuberculosis, I will show you afterwards. And the characteristic pattern of teen bud appearance and finger globes appearance are not there. Now, this is a child where it's a very recent child. Because of this X-ray, bronchoalveolar lavage and gastric lavage was done, and it was flooded with AAP. So the mistake that was done, the CBNAT was not done. And because it was fluoride tuberculosis, they started on anti-tubercular drugs. And when they came to me, I got this X-ray. And with a very thin child, I also thought that can it be a cystic fibrosis? And because of the clubbing was there. But when we did the bronchoalveolar lavage in this patient, and we found that this patient is having a rifampicin resistant. There is still positive AAP, but CBNAT showed us that this is a rifampicin resistance. Now, what's the statistics? The statistics says that in India, estimated 2.2% of new cases and 15% of previously treated cases can be multi-drug resistant tuberculosis. And what about the clubbing in tuberculosis? Is much less common, but this is a study from Saudi Arabia that 19% of the cases of tuberculosis in adults can have a tuberculosis, and especially in older children, and especially in drug-resistant tuberculosis, also look for clubbing like you look for in cystic fibrosis. Now this child, the diagnosis is left middle lobe pneumonia. Sounds funny. Now left middle lobe pneumonia, because left side doesn't have a middle lobe. So when you have a left middle lobe pneumonia, the primary ciliary dyskinesia is the diagnosis. Now this is a disease which is neglected. Neglected in comparison to the cystic fibrosis now. Now cystic fibrosis in India incidence is 1 in 40,000. Some say it's 1 in 17,000, 20,000, 10,000. But primary ciliary dyskinesia is 1 in 15,000 to 1 in 20,000. So what it means that every 5 cases of congenital hypothyroidism that you see, you are supposed to get 1 case of primary ciliary dyskinesia. But do you really get it? No. Why? Because we don't think of it. And we don't have the tools to diagnose. Now, how do you diagnose primary ciliary dyskinesia? Firstly, the history, right from the beginning, there will be little chesty cough all throughout the years. And then you have got 3 important tests that you can do. You can do a nitric oxide level if it is more than 5 years, and if it is low, you can do the think of PCT. You can do the genetic testing, which is positive in 50 to 80% of the cases. And then also you can do electron microscopy of ciliary structure. That is quite characteristic. Whether there is a problem in dynein arm, next in junctions or radial spokes. These are the ones where you can see in electron microscope can be diagnostic. And high-speed video microscopy is the one which can also help you in the diagnosis. As I said, the genetic test can be in 50 to 60% of the cases. There are only 1 or 2 centers where you can do the video microscopy, and this is the Pushyami Memorial Hospital where you can do the primary ciliary dyskinesia high-speed video microscopy. Neutropenia with pneumonia. Very rare. It's a Coastman syndrome, but you need to think of, and you can now do the genetic studies for gene LN and HAX1 study. And this is the one where if you give the filgrastim, the dose of filgrastim varies. It might be from 5 microgram per kg per day to 100 microgram per kg per day. I know it is costly, but some children respond at a very lower dose. But unfortunately, in this child, when we treated, the child improved, went back to the village and couldn't afford the treatment and came back again with a very florid pneumonia, and the child ultimately died. So when you hear hoof beats, think of horses, not zebras. That's usually the common one. Don't diagnose a rare disease, you will be rarely correct. But there are situations when you hear hoof beats, think of a zebra also. In my first day in clinical class at medical college, I said a rare cause. A copybook type from the books, I said, and my teacher said, never diagnose a rare disease and you will be rarely correct. That's 100% true, but not 100%. I would say 99% true, not 100%. These cases, although rare individually, collectively are not that uncommon. So this 13-year-old boy from Domjur, Howrah, with bouts of cough without expectoration for 5 years, noisy respiration for 2 years. He came with this x-ray. He was given anti-tubercular drugs twice, and before starting the third, they came to us for the opinion. We did the CT scan of the chest. It didn't look a miliary tuberculosis to us, so we did a lung biopsy. But to our utter surprise, when we did the lung biopsy, we thought that as if we have done the thyroid biopsy. See the colored follicles, the papillary glands, and this is what, this is a thyroid metastasis into the lungs. So that's the reason you are seeing this picture. And the lung metastasis, kidney, thyroid, and sarcoma of the bones. And then we did the nuclear scan. We showed that the left lobe is photopenic and the right lobe, in one third of the right lobe, is photopenic. So less than 10% of thyroid malignancy occurs in children, and metastasis to the lungs occur in 5 to 10% of the cases. This we published later on in the Journal of Pediatric Hematology and Oncology in USA. This is further uncommon case. 9-year-old boy came with history of cough and cold, again with one course of antitubercular drugs with this x-ray. But the upper lobes are free, the lower lobes are more involved, and so we thought that it is not tuberculosis. So we thought that it must be pulmonary alveolar microlithiasis, or PAM as we call it. Now, in the differential diagnosis of PAM, you have got all this miliary tuberculosis. That's the reason patient was treated. You know, the varicella pneumonia can sometimes, fungal infections, alveolar hemosiderosis, pneumoconiosis, and also pulmonary alveolar proteinosis and metastasis from the thyroid. Nowadays, we can do this genetic study, but we didn't. We couldn't do at that time the SLC34A2 gene. So we called the sister, 4-year-old sister, and 4-year-old sister also was showing the early signs of this pulmonary alveolar microlithiasis, and we did the CT, but the CT was more horrible considering the x-ray, and so she was also suffering. And then we did the bone scan, and it showed that the moderately increased radiopressure in both the lung veins. We published as pulmonary alveolar microlithiasis way back in 2004. Now, this is the x-ray of the patient where both the lungs are occupied. And before the transplantation, this is the post-transplantation lung in Global Hospital. The post-transplantation lungs, the lungs weighed 4 kg, so much of calcium deposited, 4 kg. And the person himself, boy himself, returned to me just after my transplant. My surgery was done on 22nd, 2019. So satisfying. This is the child after the post-transplantation. I've taken his permission, and this is the post-transplantation in Global Hospital. This is a similar situation where you see this and you may think that it is a tuberculosis, until and unless some people will think of that this is a severe necrotizing pneumonia. But if you don't look at the back, the first patient didn't have anything excepting that there is these hypopigmented spots on the back. And so you need to check them properly. You need to do the skull X-ray in those cases and may see these osteolytic lesions. This is very florid and easy, but the nail changes are very characteristic of the histiocytosis. But the lung involvement is mainly in 10% cases, but in adults, the pulmonary involvement is more common. In children, the lung involvement is much less common. Adults with smoker has more chance. Now, this is an X-ray where there were some cystic changes, but the patient was getting antibiotics. But the patient, if you look at the patient, the diagnosis will be much more easy. After giving antibiotics, a CT scan was done to see this cyst in the lung, but actually it's in the anterior part of the chest. There are some intestines. Then we did the barium study, and this showed that this is a foramen of Morgagni hernia. But if you look at the child right in the beginning, that it's a Down syndrome child, and Down syndrome children has more chances of Morgagni hernia. In one of the study, it has been seen out of 5 live-born infants with hernia Morgagni recorded in California birth defects monitoring program, 3 had trisomy 21. So it's that common, the Morgagni hernia you need to think of. This is a child where both the lungs were hazy with anemia, and this is the X-ray. We did the bronchoalveolar lavage, and it was shown hemosiderin-laden macrophages. And this is Heine syndrome. The reason is that the moment we are stopping the cow's milk, the patient's hemoglobin was sustained. But as you know, in our country, people always think that the cow's milk is the best, which I don't agree at all. So this is a Heine syndrome. So what are the infantile hemoptysis are the causes? So there are some pulmonary renal syndromes. I'm not going into the infection and cystic fibrosis. I'm going into the uncommon causes of pulmonary renal syndrome and some other causes. I will show you the cases. So the diffuse alveolar hemorrhage, if you see, one is idiopathic pulmonary hemosiderosis. And sometimes, if you are lucky, it may be due to milk protein allergy. But if it is associated with other organs, out of that, kidney is one of the most important, is the good pasture syndrome, Wegener's, Hennox-Conlan purpura. But it may be due to other disease also. Celiac disease may also have a pulmonary hemorrhage. And the other is the systemic lupus erythematosus. Now, this is a systemic lupus erythematosus who almost bled in the lungs and died ultimately. So very severe condition when the systemic SLE patients bleed in the lungs. This is a 14-year-old female with recurrent epistaxis and history of headache. The sinus X-ray, because of the X-ray, showed the homogeneous opacifications with sinusitis. But what is characteristic is this skin changes, nodular skin changes, and also the eye changes that you see. And he also had a hoarseness of void and rash. CRP was very high, INR was normal, the rest hemoglobin was mildly decreased. The chest X-ray showed a huge shadow here, necrotic shadow. We thought of that, can it be tuberculosis? But the TST was negative, sputum negative, gene expert negative, and despite antibiotics, high spiking fever persisted. What the patient also had, the protein in the urine was 3+, and the RBC was plenty. We did then see ANCA after involvement of the nephrologist, pediatric nephrologist, and we did the C ANCA was positive. So C ANCA positive means there is a high chance of Wegener's granulomatosis, which is now called GPA or granulomatous polyangiitis. But in case of microscopic polyangiitis, it is the P-ANCA which is positive. So we did a proteinase 3, and it was strong positivity for proteinase 3. That's again very characteristic of Wegener's granulomatosis. We did the biopsy, and what the biopsy showed, that there are epithelioid granuloma and ANCA positive, with the ANCA positive, it is very likely that it is a Wegener's granulomatosis or GPA. So because it's a granulomatous one, the changes that has been seen, it is GPA. But in case of microscopic polyangiitis, it is non-granulomatous one, but both are necrotizing. The other pulmonary renal syndromes are microscopic polyangiitis, which I have discussed, sarcoidosis, and good posture syndrome. Good posture syndrome is much less common in children than in adults. Now, in our case, it fulfilled almost all the criteria for Wegener's granulomatosis. These are the six, only you need three, but our patient has almost all. So this patient was treated with methylprednisolone, oral corticosteroid, and cyclophosphamide, and this is the child. Now, this is a two-year-old child who came with gradual pallor and no history of obvious blood loss and pallor. The hemoglobin was 2.5. So we thought that something being lost somewhere, because in iron deficiency anemia, usually it doesn't come. And we treated with iron therapy, it didn't work. With the transfusion, the patient's hemoglobin fell down again. We did the repeat hemoglobin 4.5 after 1 month when they came for follow-up. So we thought that it's a refractory iron deficiency anemia, or IRIDA nowadays, as it is called. But the child had a cough, so we did the X-ray, and X-ray showed diffuse shadows in both the lungs. So then we started thinking that, is it a celiac disease or celiac disease with pulmonary hemorrhage? We did the bronchoalveolar lavage just to prove that it is a hemorrhage, and it was positive. We did a gastric lavage, it was positive. Then we did the biopsy, and it showed the characteristic features of flattening intraepithelial lymphocytes and also elongation of the crypts. So that confirmed that this is a celiac disease. Now, when you have these two common, that pulmonary hemorrhage and celiac disease, it's called Lane-Hamilton syndrome. Very uncommon condition, but it can happen. As I said, that hoof beasts are not always horses. So we treated with steroids, HCQS, and a gluten-free diet, and after 2 months, the patient improved. This is a child who presented to us with failure to thrive from around 2 months onwards. In the history, the baby was fed artificial milk, not the breast milk. Initially was given breast milk, but then changed into artificial milk, and had a hepatosplenomegaly. So with the fever, hepatosplenomegaly, and a growth chart like this, we thought that we'll have to give the antituberculous drugs. But there was not enough evidence. We are not finding any cause for to give antituberculous drugs. So we referred the patient, and this is the X-ray, and we referred the patient to All Institute of Medical Science, where it was said to be a milk protein allergy and aspiration, and steroid was given. The patient improved, and we stopped the milk, and the patient didn't have any problem. So this is another child in 2015, the X-ray bilateral ones are the shadows. And these are the shadows which is deteriorating, which is further deteriorating, and further deteriorating. And we were scared to give steroid in this case. Again, this case we refer to Dr. Sushil Kabra, who said that there is an aspiration of dal protein because the grandmother, she's the one who used to force feed with rice and dal, and that was being aspirated. And the patients improved after that. So here comes the hypersensitivity pneumonitis in both those two cases, which has got a definite criteria. I'm not going into the detail, but what I mean to say that they usually present like a tuberculosis, X-ray changes, failure to thrive, but and sometimes hepatosplenomegaly, cough, cold, but you need to do some precipitin test, both IgG and IgM. Radiologic changes are hypersensitivity like nodularity, interstitial changes, and mainly in the middle and the lower lung zones are the features. If you can do the CD4, CD8 count in the bronchoalveolar lavage, then it is quite characteristic of less than 1 ratio of CD4, CD8. Histology can be confirmatory, but usually we don't do. And there are some minor criteria like carbon monoxide diffusion capacity. I'm not going into the detail. How do you confirm? That mainly the clinical, but CT scan gives a ground glass appearance. And in older child, you can do a lung function test, which will give you a restrictive lung disease pattern. How do you treat them? You treat them avoidance of the offending agents and corticosteroids. So this is a child which looked like a cardiomegaly. So first investigations we did, because the child had fever, so we thought that it might be a pericardial effusion because nothing we could hear. So we went for an echocardiography. Echocardiography was normal. So we did a CT scan of the chest, and CT scan with the chest contrast shows that there is a mass in the anterior mediastinum. So when you have a mass in the anterior mediastinum, think of this 5T: thymus, thyroid, thoracic aorta, terrible lymphoma, and teratoma. This child turned out to be a terrible lymphoma. Now, this child came with a back pain. Didn't have any cough symptoms, but had a back pain. So we did the MRI of the back, but MRI showed that there is something in the lungs, and we did a chest X-ray after that. That's the other way around that we have gone in this case. And this is the shadow that we have. And this was diagnosed as thymoma. And because the prognosis of this thymoma is very poor, after the biopsy, they had the thymic carcinoma. The local hospital here refused to treat and told them that the prognosis is very bad. They went to a higher center in Mumbai, and this is the X-ray after the treatment. And the diagnosis was lymphoepithelial like carcinoma of the thymus. The child succumbed ultimately. Happy child wheezing. I always say, though IIP may not agree to that, if a child is wheezing and you are giving inhalers and nebulizers, do a chest X-ray. In the current scenario, with so many medical legal cases around, do a chest X-ray. And this chest X-ray showed this, and the second chest X-ray showed this. So we did an MRI because we always say that don't do CT scan much. If you are doing, if you are trying to look at the interstitium, that's the reason where you need to see the, you need to do the CT scan or HRCT. So there was a cyst, and in the middle mediastinum. So this is a bronchogenic cyst, which is a developmental defect from the tracheobronchial origin and presenting as recurrent wheeze. So this is a similar shadow. The first shadow you have seen is on the right side, because bronchogenic cysts are usually on the right side. Now this shadow is on the left side. And the CT scan showed that there is a mass in the posterior mediastinum. And this turned out to be a neuroblastoma. The mass in the posterior mediastinum are usually neuroblastoma in children, or enterogenous cyst, or pulmonary sequestration. So these are the posterior mediastinal masses. So this 5-month-old child presented with pallor and diminished activity, and his hemoglobin was 2.7 gram per cent, and stool contained a lot of RBCs. The X-ray showed a shadow like this, and so we did a barium swallow, and the barium swallow showed that something is pushing the esophagus. So there must be a mass here which is pushing in the posterior mediastinum. We did a CT scan, and there is a huge mass here, and which has gone to the suprapancreatic region into the abdomen. We did the angiography. It shows that the mass is not fed by the systemic vessels. It was operated, and it was a gastroesophageal duplication cyst. And this is a shadow where every time it was thought of a pneumonia, but it's actually a kidney in an abnormal position. One of my greatest blunder that I did 20 years back, in those days, I was treating this cerebral palsy child. He was having recurrent pneumonia. We didn't have enough evidence, endoscopy by the children's, there was not enough pediatric gastroenterologist. So I did a barium swallow, and instead of barium swallow, it also became a bronchography. It went to the lungs. So if you do the bronchograph barium swallow in a child where you are suspecting, you should do the gastrography rather than the barium. This is a very simple, it's CPAM. The name for cystic adenomatous malformation has been changed, as you know, and the most common type 1, which is large cyst in 60 to 70% in Stocker classification. And similarly, this is a congenital lobar emphysema, which the name of which has also been changed into a pulmonary hyperinflation syndrome, congenital pulmonary hyperinflation. Before I end, as I said, that most of the times we are being cheated with the diagnosis of asthma. Think twice before you label a child as asthma. This child came to me with 9 x-rays in 6 years because of the recurrent cough and cold. What was missed is that his eye had some changes, and it was thought that it's an allergy with asthma, but it's very characteristic that it is an ataxia telangiectasia. And in ataxia telangiectasia, the X-rays are damaging, not like xeroderma pigmentosa. Here, the X-rays and some radioiometric chemicals and ultraviolet, but not to ultraviolet radiations, they can damage. And they also have a chance of thymus malignancy. And in these cases, definitely you are not going to do a CT scan, but to do an MRI. So again, I say that follow the ALERA principle, that as much as possible low radiation as achievable. Thank you. I think I overshooted the time a little bit, but sorry for that.
Thank you so much, sir. That was a wonderful presentation.
Sunita, it is echoing. Somebody has kept two things, mobile and something like that.
I don't have anything on.
Okay, it is echoing. Yeah, now
you speak. Ma'am, I think you can, if you mute, sir, I think it will be not echo.
No, I don't have any phone here.
Yeah, now you speak, Sumita. It is not echoing now.
Okay. Sir, would you please stop the sharing? Then we'll get you on the main screen.
Okay, I don't know. Again, I will.
Same thing, same button, sir. Share button is the stop button.
Stop button. Stop sharing. Yes.
Yes, sir. Same thing.
Wonderful. So I think we had an excellent presentation, sir. You have presented your cases and your experience, including the pitfalls that you have faced. So I think this goes way beyond any textbook description of any of these conditions. So we are really indebted to you. Thank you so much, sir, for doing this presentation.
Extremely sharp person. He went to UK, but because he was blacklisted, he was not allowed to do his membership. So he went to Boston Children's Hospital, where he worked with Professor Neuhauser.
Topic and tips and everything. So thanks to GSK also. Hope GSK will continue.